Last lecture, we have introduced and discussed the two basic multiplets that one actually needs, two basic superfields one needs to describe a supersymmetric Lagrangian if one is not interested in gravitational theories. And in particular, the chiral multiplet, the chiral superfield, phi, and the vector superfield, b. And we have discussed the structure as functions of x, theta, theta bar. They are special projection of the most general superfield. This is the chiral projection, which says that the bar alpha dot of phi is zero. One can equivalently define an anti-chiral superfield which satisfy the alpha equals zero. And we have seen that the basic degrees of freedom contain a chiral superfield are nothing but those of a matter multiplet, that's a Bessel multiplet, namely a scalar field, a Majorana, a Weyl spinor of definite chirality, and another complex scalar. So two complex scalars and one by fermion. Notice that this definition it's generic, but we have chosen phi to be without any extra indices. As we will see later, you can have a superfield whose lowest component is not a scalar field like phi, but maybe it's a vector or a fermion, and then you go on with the representation. This is not an issue. I mean, the possibility that there is an extra index here, alpha, alpha dot, alpha beta, whatever, it's fine, and we will see examples. The important thing is that this equation is satisfied. So there are certain bosonic and fermionic degrees of freedom. The lowest component, lowest when you think about a superfield, means the component without thetas in the expansion, fixes the tensorial structure, if you want, of the superfield, and the rest follows. So here I wrote I consider a generic chiral superfield sigma, let me call it sigma, and this is the expansion we found in the X space once you expand from Y to X, remember. And the longest component is a complex scalar, but if you add here an alpha index, there would be an alpha index here, and then this would become a vector, and so on and so forth. So, because once this is fixed, the rest follows by the property of the thetas, which are spinors. Okay? Is this clear? Okay. The other superfield we have introduced is the vector superfield, which is just a superfield which satisfies a reality condition. V dagger is equal to V, and the effect of this is that in the general expansion you save the vector and make it real, which was our goal, to have a vector. Then we discussed the generalization of gauge invariance at the level of superfield, and we also discussed a very convenient way to fix the gauge, modulo the actual gauge we like, namely the possibility to do gauge transformation on the vector, which is the Bessel-Zwinnow gauge. And in that gauge, a vector superfield has a very simple expression because its lowest component, indeed is not a scalar, has already two thetas, one theta and one theta bar, if you remember. Okay, this was the summary. What we want to do today is to construct finally, to come to our main goal, one of the main goals of this course, namely to construct supersymmetric invariant actions made of chiral and vector superfields. The standard model, supersymmetric, an n equal to 1 supersymmetric extension of the standard model will be a complicated full of fields, but will be a supersymmetric Lagrangian having these two guys around. Okay? So I will start first discussing matter actions. So our goal at the beginning, for now, is to discuss matter actions, meaning supersymmetric invariant Lagrangian actions, describing the self-interaction of chiral superfields. Then we will discuss engage interactions, and then we will put finally the two things together tomorrow, gauge and matter, to have what is like something like the standard model, which we have the vectors, scalars, fermions, all interacting, matter is charged under some gauge symmetry, a global symmetry, and so on and so forth. Okay? So we start from matter action, so, and to make life simpler, because we will learn a lot already at this level, we will focus just for the moment discussing what is the supersymmetric action describing the self-interaction of a parallel superfit. In previous courses, for example, we have discussed, I don't know, scalar theory, I'm sure, phi to the 4 theory, phi to the cube theory, is a Lagrangian in which you describe the propagation of a scalar field with the cubic or quartic interaction. Or you can discuss the propagation, and or you can study the interaction between a scalar and a fermion with the Kawa coupling and so on and so forth. All these things are fine. We would like to write the supersymmetric version of these things, and you will appreciate the power of the formalism, the superfield formalism that we have introduced last week. Okay, so I start from one kind of superfield, phi. And our goal is what I just said. Okay, so let me consider the following integral. Okay, remember that our idea is that an action, a supersymmetric invariant action, is something like the integral in d4x of an object, which is a Lagrangian, which should be invariant under supersymmetric transformation modulo total spacetime derivative. And we have discussed that this should, using the superfield formalism, should be written this way. Where A is a superfield. If A is a superfield, this is guaranteed to be supersymmetric invariant. This would be eventually our Lagrangian, okay? Is the idea. And also discussed that this superfield, in order for this to be an action, and therefore this is a Lagrangian, if this is a superfield, this automatically satisfies supersymmetry invariance. But then we need something else for this to be a Lagrangian, a real object, dimension 4, and things like that. And so this will translate in property of A. So it's not enough to integrate a generic superfield. I mean, you know. Okay. But what is real is that if this is a superfield, this is a putative supersymmetric invariant object. Okay. Now we have one superfield at disposal, a chiral superfield. And now I propose to consider, so I will focus on this kind of construction. And we will call that Lagrangian, right? So let me consider the following integral. Phi double phi. Let's look at the properties of this integral. First of all, this integral, let me call it I is SUS invariant. Modulo up to total spacetime derivative, which is all what we are interested in. Why? Because phi is a superfield, phi bar is also a superfield, is an anti-chiral superfield. Their product is a superfield, because if you remember how superfield transform, under SUS transformation, the product of two superfields is still a superfield. So phi bar phi, call it what you like, is a superfield. So for using the proof that we did last time, this is a supersymmetric invariant object, this integral I. Is it clear or not? Second, I is real and is a real and a scalar object. Two other properties that a Lagrangian should have. A Lagrangian should be real and a scalar. Scalar, I mean, should transform as a scalar density. I mean, should not have three indices, so to say. Let me claim that this is true here. That name that I is real and a scalar. How to say this? Now, if you take phi bar phi and expand, you notice that 5 bar 5, remember this, okay, 5 is a Keller superfield, so it has an expansion like this. 5 bar is its bar expansion, we have discussed that. So the lowest component of this thing is phi dagger x phi of x plus higher order, theta, 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 okay? But the lowest component is this, if you take the mean. So this lowest component is real and scalar. It's a scalar because that's not a three indices, and it's real because it's phi dagger phi. Now, if you do this integration, what is saved is not this component. This is killed by the integration into theta. The only part which survives is this. In all this expansion, another nice property of superfield polymorphism, in order to know what is the answer to this question, what is this equal to, you don't have to compute all this mess. It's enough to compute the theta 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 bar theta bar component because it's the only one which will not be killed by this integration. Remember the property of Lanzmann numbers and integration. Okay? However, theta 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 bar is a real and a scalar thing. It's real because if you take theta 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 bar and take the dagger, this is nothing but theta 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 bar theta bar, as you can easily see going back to our all our conventions and notation. Remember, this is theta alpha, theta bar alpha dot, theta, theta bar alpha dot. Okay? So this object is real. And is a scalar object because that's not every indices. Since all this piece is this has the same structure of all this piece, since this piece has the same property of this, this is also the case. So this is a real and scalar object. Right? And since this is exactly what survived this integration, I is a real and scalar object. Is it clear? Finally, so I is a real and scalar object. Okay? The last property that this integral has is that I has dimension 4. Namely, as a Lagrangian should have. Proof? Again, what is the dimension of the lowest component? What is the dimension of a scalar field?
One.
In four dimension?
One.
So 5 bar 5 is dimension 2, right?
Okay.
So this guy is dimension 2. Okay? Okay? But this is not the guy that survived the integration. This is the guy that survived the integration. Now we have to check whether theta and theta bar might have some physical dimension. Now, if you look here, the answer is obvious. What is the dimension of theta? A dimension which compensates that of psi to make this having the same dimension of this, because you cannot add pears with apples. Now, if this is dimension 1, for example, if it is a scalar field, as it is the case here, and psi, as you know very well, is dimension 3 half in 4 dimension, then theta is dimension minus 1 half. Mm-hmm. So the dimension of theta is minus 1 half. Similar reasoning for theta bar, because there's no difference, right? It's just another expansion. Phi bar plus root of 2 theta bar psi bar, psi bar and psi has both dimension. Yeah. Okay. So the dimension of these things is minus 2. And and therefore the dimension of this is 4. Another way to see this is to notice that this is equal to what? The only part which is saved is this, right? As we were saying. All the rest is killed. This is dimension minus 2. This, what is the dimension of this? If theta is dimension minus 1 half, what is the dimension of d theta? If you think in terms of usual bosonic coordinates, you will say, well, the same. X and dx have the same dimension. But this is wrong for Grassmann numbers, because remember that integration is the same as the derivative. So d theta is the dimension of d over d theta. So the dimension of d theta is plus 1 half. So this is dimension 2. 2 minus 2 is 0. So this, since this is dimensionless, should be dimension, this should have dimension 4, which is what we have proved. Okay? Okay. So this integral, which I just proposed as an exercise, has all the properties that a supersymmetric Lagrangian or a piece of a supersymmetric Lagrangian should have. And it's made by a Cayley superfilm, which is our hero in this first part of the lecture. So, nice. Why don't we compute it and see what we get? Okay, now that we know that it has all the nice properties, why don't we compute explicitly? See, let's see what we get, right? Okay, let's do it. Now, remember that phi of x, phi is equal to, in the y coordinates, which is this easiest way to write it, but we have to integrate in d2t with the bar, so in order to do the computation, and so you can easily multiply phi bar, and then you know what phi bar is. I give you the recipe, no? Similarly, you can find phi bar in this way. So you take the product, and then you have to save the part which is quadratic in theta and theta bar, because it's the only one which survives, right? The problem is that this is not just the product of f and f bar, because in the belly here, when you expand, there is also, remember, no? So the price is that this is nice, but then it's better to use the full expansion to understand what is the theta bar component of this product, okay? So our goal is to compute phi bar phi, not all of it, is theta bar component. This will be this, automatically the result. Do you agree? Okay, so better to look at this. Think of this sigma to be a phi, in phi bar. I hope you have enough, you can, you know, okay? So, let me delete. So, okay, so the logical step you have to follow is to start from phi and phi bar into the y coordinates and expand. This is an exercise we did already last week, so it's written here. I write the other guy. I write sigma because I want to be generic, but then we call it phi for us, but any kind of superfield has this expansion. So in order to emphasize that this is not specific to phi, but to any kind of superfield, I change letters. So let me write it. Okay? So I want to compute this product. Okay? Again, sigma is 5 for me. Here it is just something I keep that. Okay. So, well, the lowest component with the upper component, the lowest component with the upper component is a contribution. I start from the bottom and go up, no? So from that I get the following contribution, theta theta, theta bar, minus 1/4, phi box phi bar, minus 1/4, phi bar box phi. This is clear, right? Lowest, upper, upper, lower. Then let's look at this. Is there a term here which multiplied by this gives 2 theta and 2 theta bar? Then we use Wirth's identities and so on, but yes, this is the one. This is 1 theta and 2 theta bar. There is 1 theta, so all in all is 4 theta. 2 theta, okay? Then we play with the identities, but the number of theta is fine. So this thing is, the only contribution is when this is multiplied by this. Then we will go on, okay? So we get plus I theta psi, theta bar, theta sigma mu, d mu, psi bar. You agree? The square root of 2 simplifies with the square root of 2. There is an I, theta psi, theta bar, sigma. Then there is the other friend, which is the this times this. Same. Okay, so this, then let's take this. There are 2 theta. Sorry, I was wrong. Sorry. This will go with this. I'm saying that this, as there is this piece with this piece, there is this piece with this piece. I just write the same line for later convenience. So there is also minus I theta theta d mu psi sigma mu theta bar psi bar. Okay, so now I took this times this. Then correctly, there is that guy. So 1 theta and 1 theta bar, 1 theta and 1 theta bar is the only one. So take the product, plus I minus I is a plus. So this is theta sigma nu theta bar di nu phi theta sigma mu theta bar di mu phi bar, and finally f plus theta 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 bar f bar f. Do you agree? There's nothing else. Okay? This with 2 theta, I have to find somebody with 2 theta bar here. This is the one. And that's it, there are no other pieces. All others have not enough or too much theta. If they have too much theta, they automatically zero. If they don't have enough theta, they are killed by this measure. So the only terms are those with 4 theta, particularly 2 theta and 2 theta bar. Is it clear? Okay. Now I can rearrange this guy. I delete this thing. Let me use the following identities that we have seen some of the first days. Remember, I have to rewrite all these as theta theta bar times something, because this is the thing that is killed by this giving a 1. So I have to play a little bit, I have to do some work. Well, this is equal to 1/2 theta theta, theta bar, theta mu nu. So this piece, I can rewrite. And the other observation is that theta psi times theta sigma mu di mu psi bar, which is this piece here, for example, I have a theta bar, theta bar, which is fine, but then I have theta psi, theta this. I need the theta, theta. So I have to take this and this, I use some of the identities. You can rearrange this in the following way. This is minus 1 half, theta, theta, psi sigma mu, d mu, psi bar. You understand? Theta, theta means theta alpha, theta alpha. So this was theta alpha, psi alpha, theta beta, sigma mu, beta alpha dot, psi bar alpha dot. I have to rearrange to, no? And similarly, you can use the following identity, that theta bar psi bar times theta bar sigma bar mu d mu psi is equal to minus theta bar psi bar d mu psi sigma mu theta bar, which is, you see, I have this thing here, which is precisely this, that is precisely this modular sign. This is equal to plus 1 half theta bar, d mu psi, sigma mu psi bar. So this piece, modular sign, is equal to this. And this is precisely the piece that I have here, you see? This is already organized with 2 theta. So this was okay. This is okay. This I have rearranged, and these two also. Now I can put everything together and write this, all this mess, as theta 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 bar times what? Here I can integrate by parts. Remember that eventually we have a d4x, so we don't care about total space time derivative. So this can be written as integrating by parts. This is box means d mu d mu is d mu of everything minus 1/4 d mu phi bar, and the same here, so they add. So in other words, this is nothing but 1 plus 1/4 d mu phi bar plus 1/4 d mu phi bar d mu phi. Remember that we don't care about total space time derivative once again, because eventually we will this is defined for our purposes modulo total space time derivative, because there is an extra d4x integration at the very end, right? Okay. Then I have a plus 1 half theta 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 bar from here. I have another piece, because this remember the identity, I use this piece becomes then I have theta 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 bar f bar f. So I've taken care of this, and of this. Now we have these two extra pieces, but using these things, this can be written as minus I divided by 2 theta 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 bar psi sigma mu d mu psi bar plus I divided by 2 theta 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 bar d mu psi sigma mu psi bar. Okay, so finally I can put together all these terms. Okay, 1/4 plus 1/4 is 1/2 plus another 1/2 is just 1, and then I have this and this. Okay, so now I have the answer. I can write here. Are you following? So I delete these identities that we use just for computational purposes, and we get as an answer theta 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 bar, which is killed by this, and it's a 1 in our convention and notation, d mu phi bar plus f bar f plus I divided by 2 d mu psi sigma mu psi bar minus psi sigma mu d mu psi bar. This is the answer of our computation. What is this? Well, this is nice. This is nothing but the kinetic term of a massless scalar plus the kinetic term of a massless Weyl frame. In two component spinor notation, this is the correct way to write a kinetic term. If four components, if you translate this into four component spinor notation using the dictionary I gave you, this becomes what you expect. And then there is also another quadratic term for the field F, which is not phi, is F. So the integration of phi bar phi not only has all the properties to be supersymmetric Lagrangian, but gives precisely a piece that we know very well, the kinetic term, which we need to have. Moreover, as promised, these show that F is an auxiliary field. Why? Because what is the equation of motion for phi from this Lagrangian? Box phi equals zero. What is the equation of motion for psi, the Dirac equation? Well, okay? So if you want this slash psi equals zero. What is the equation of motion for F? F bar equals zero. So on a shell F, F bar equals zero or F equals zero is the same. On shell F is not, this is a propagating degree of freedom. This is a propagating degree of freedom. This is not, this is just F equals zero. So it was, as promised, an auxiliary field. It does not disturb any propagating degree of freedom. So on shell, we go from four fermionic equal to four bosonic degrees of freedom to two bosonic and two fermionic degrees of freedom, as promised and perfectly consistent with the representation of states that we constructed for n equal to 1 supersymmetry with maximum spin 1 half. So this is very good. So you see, okay, this is not so complicated even in field formalism, but three pieces as this with derivatives, in superfield formalism is just the simplest thing you can imagine, phi dagger phi. So you see how easy it is. Now this is not, it's like using a bazooka to kill a mosquito, but when you write a big Lagrangian, you understand that the superfield formalism will make it very, very simple. Not only, now you look at this, somebody asks you, is this supersymmetric invariant? Well, suppose we didn't go to all these superfield formalism. Well, okay, this is a bit simple, but, well, you have to go back to the formula we derived last week, or actually, to be honest, I just mentioned to you, no? We have seen that the variation under a supersymmetric transformation of phi is a square root of 2 epsilon psi. The variation of psi alpha is a square root of 2 I sigma mu epsilon bar index alpha d mu phi minus square root of 2 epsilon alpha f. And the variation of f was I square root of 2 d mu psi sigma mu epsilon bar. So if somebody asks you, is this expression supersymmetric invariant? You have to act on this Lagrangian with the Suzy transformation. So you have to transform phi, f, and psi in this way, do the computation, integrate by part of something if you want, and then show that varying with respect to supersymmetry all this mesh, you get a total space time derivative. It's doable, but it's pretty involved, and not to mention when we have interactions. Thanks to the superfield formalism, we don't have to do any single computation. Since this comes from integrating in superspace a superfield, this is automatically supersymmetric invariant. Because we have proven it in general last week. This is one of the power of the superfield formalism. Okay? Okay. This is nice, very good. However, it's not enough. Because we want to describe matter action. And this integral describes the kinetic term, fine, but we would like to discuss also to introduce interactions between psi and phi in a supersymmetric way. So we have to do something more complicated than this, to do something besides describing the propagation of a free massless chiral multiple. This describes the propagation of a free massless chiral multiple, just three fields, right? Okay. So we want to do something more than this. We have to. This is fine, this is good, but it's not enough. So can we do more? This is the question. Can we have a more general Lagrangian, which besides the kinetic term gives to us interaction, say? Well, let's then try to be more general. So instead of writing phi bar phi, let's write some function of phi and phi bar, more general in principle, and see, and impose on this general function all the properties that a Lagrangian should have, and see if as an answer we get something more than just phi bar phi. And what we get more will be probably, I don't know, we have to see, trial and error, the missing pieces. Okay? Is the logic clear?
Good.
So let me consider the following integral. So for the moment this is mathematics, okay. A function k of phi and phi bar. A possible choice being just phi bar phi. Okay. But let me be more general and ask, what are the properties that this function k should have as a function of phi and phi bar to be a putative piece of a Lagrangian? And let's see if listing the property we get as an answer just this, or hopefully something else, something more. Okay? So, which are the properties that k should have? First, k should be a superfield. In other words, why? Well, because if and only if k is a superfield, it's integrally supersymmetric invariant modulo total space time derivative. So the requirement that k is a superfield is a requirement imposed by supersymmetry, like this was a superfield, in fact. It was the reason why we said, good, this can be supersymmetric invariant modulo total space time derivative. So the first requirement is that k should be a superfield. The second requirement that k should satisfy is that k should be a real and scalar object. Why? Because if its lowest k will be a function of phi and phi bar, so it will expand, no? Itself is a superfield, so will be a very complicated expansion, but in x didn't it about, so it will have a lowest component and blah blah blah. Its lowest component, we have learned before that the lowest component, as far as reality and tensorial and Lorentz transformation property, the lowest component has the same property of the theta 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 bar theta bar component. So if the lowest component is real and scalar, also the theta 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 bar component, which is the only one surviving the integration, has the same property. So since the properties of a superfield are dictated by the lowest component, no, because you start from, as I said, apple, and then you add apples, call it apple, the lowest component, k should be a real and scalar object. So you can invent any function of phi phi bar, but the lowest component should be real and scalar. So for example, the lowest component, k cannot be, I don't know, phi times phi squared times phi bar, because this is, the lowest component of this is not real. Is phi bar plus blah blah blah, and this is not real. So you see, it's not. This is a big constraint. Okay. Okay. So the first requirement is to ensure supersymmetry. The second requirement is to ensure that the Lagrangian is dictated by the fact that the Lagrangian is a real and scalar object. And finally, k should have dimension 2, namely k should be equal to 2. Why? Because if k is dimension 2, namely its lowest component is dimension 2, the theta 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 bar component has dimension k plus 2, so 4, which is what we need. Why? Because what we discussed before. Stop me if you don't follow. Okay. Finally, k. So, supersymmetry, Lagrangian being a scalar and real object, dimension 4 object, because the action is dimensionless in natural units, that is the units we are using, h bar equal to c equal to 1, remember? Finally, k should not contain cioè should be a function of phi and phi bar, but not, cioè should be a function of phi bar, but should not be a function of something like d alpha phi bar or d bar alpha dot d alpha phi or d bar alpha dot phi bar. Let me explain. Remember that d alpha bar, this is zero because phi is a Carrier superfield, right? But another object that you can write, which is this, this is not zero and is a superfield because phi is a superfield, is a Carrier superfield. The alpha is a constraint that you can put on a field, remember? So this object, call it, I don't know, psi alpha, this is a superfield. So is a, is a, so if you have psi alpha inside the belly of K, you respect the first three properties, you respect this property, for example. But the reason why, so you could have this piece in general. So you can have phi and phi bar could also enter from the, in this way, from the point of view of supersymmetry. But they cannot enter in this way for another point of view, which is the following. We have seen that already the simplest expression without derivative already contains two derivative terms. So it's easy to get convinced that if you add pieces like that, you will get a theory with higher derivatives. Since we want to keep a theory, study a theory two derivative term if you want, no? This is to avoid a theory with higher derivative. Our first goal is to describe something like the standard model, supersymmetric extension of the standard model, in which there are no higher derivative terms. Okay? So you can easily check that covariant derivative would add, would give rise to an higher derivative theory with three derivative of I, okay? Which cannot be accepted in a local field theory. So it is not difficult, okay, so these are the four properties you have to satisfy, and it's not difficult to show that the most generic function of phi and phi bar, which satisfies these four properties, which are strong enough, is the following. The most general function is this. I write and then we will elaborate upon. Is equal to the sum on M and N from 1 to infinity of some coefficient Cmn times phi bar to the m, phi to the n, with the requirement that Cmn is equal to C star n m. Notice that if you choose m and n equal both to 1, so this thing that we computed is a subset of this, okay? So let me check, at least I prove for you, I claim that it's the most general solution, okay? You can do it yourself, I just show you that this satisfies all those properties. Is a K a superfield? Yes, because it's the sum of products of superfields, whatever m and n are, so it's a superfield. Is K a real and scalar object? Yes, and for that this is crucial, because you see here I'm allowing also pieces that I excluded before, like phi bar square times phi. This is not okay. But this requirement implies that there is automatically in this sum also the Hermitian conjugate, and the coefficient be the star of it. So this is not a real, is real, but there is a, in this sum automatically the other one. So if this is not there, it means that C, if this is not there, this, if the coefficient Cmn corresponding to this, which is C21, is not there, then automatically also C12 is not there. And so they are both zero, so fine. So if there is one, there is the other. This is the requirement. So this guarantees reality, okay? When you have m and n be equal, like here, you don't have to have this requirement, you have only one term, which is automatically real. But here we are allowing a more general solution. K should have dimension 2. Okay. Well, that's fine. Like, in the sense that this is telling you something about the dimension of these couplings. If you look at this expression, you remember that phi has dimension 1, phi bar also, and you think about this and that requirement, this simply tells you that Cmn, if you call lambda, so it shows you that for m equal to n equal to 1, which was this case, CMM is dimensionless. For any other value of m and m, in which both or one of the two is larger than 1, this is a negative mass dimension to compensate, right? So automatically, as soon as you allow higher power than just m equal to n equal to 1, you are describing an effective theory with dimension couples which have negative dimension that you know are non-renormalizable. So you automatically have a UV cutoff, a physical UV cutoff in your theory. You can, looking at this dimension, it's easy to see that the dimension of these couples, these couples are numbers times a dimension. And the dimension will be order lambda 2 minus m plus n. And indeed, only for m plus n equal to 2, which is the case there, this is 0. All the other cases, this wins against 2, and so this has negative mass dimension. Okay? So provided that you allow these couples to be negative mass dimension, you can allow all these terms. Okay, so there are no covariant derivatives. Okay, these functions, okay, for reasons that I cannot explain in this course, but just for curiosity, I tell you, is called Keeler potential. Take this just as a sort of terminology, even though there is a deep geometric reason why this is called Keeler potential. But okay, this is behind the scope of this course. Now, if I want to say, make another comment about this. Suppose we want to describe supersymmetric theory which are renormalizable, like the standard model is a renormalizable theory, right? So if you make it supersymmetric, you would like to have a renormalizable supersymmetric theory. After all, we like supersymmetry precisely because it has very nice UV properties, no? So if so this K is the most general solution of this list. But if on that list you also impose, I want to describe a renormalizable theory, then this automatically kills all these sum except that. Because for any M and N, for any term in this sum, which is not just the lowest, this describes a non-renormalizable theory. So what we found before is the most general Keeler potential, if on top of all the usual requirements, you also ask renormalizability. This is good and bad at the same time. It's good because, okay, this is pretty simple. It's bad because, okay, this is nice. So suppose you want to describe a renormalizable theory, but interacting. Well, there is no way using supersymmetry, because the only option beyond propagating massless and free scalar and Fermion is something non-renormalizable. But this is for the moment the price. Second comment, this was the first comment. Don't worry, there is a solution. If renorm is required, then all CMN are zero but C11, and so the Keeler potential is just 5/5. Phi dagger phi. Remember, I use a bar in place of dagger in my notation. The second comment is that you could have added in this list also terms in which you have one of the m or n zero and the other one non-zero. I have excluded them, you see, but they satisfy all the properties. In other words, you could have something like phi on this plus also term like phi plus phi bar. So this is C01, C10, I take them to be one the star of the other, 1, 1, and this is the bar. So this is real. You can also add phi square plus phi bar square. So in principle, this sum can be extended, allowing also M and M starting from zero. It's fine. The only reason why I didn't add, so if you like, you can put zero here. There's no, it's fine. The reason I didn't add it is just because these terms Once integrated in the 2 theta, the 2 theta bar gives automatically zero. Why? Modulo total space time derivative, which we don't care about. Why? Well, because this is a chiral superfield, right? This is also a chiral superfield because the product of two chiral superfields is a chiral superfield. It's easy to see. So if phi satisfies the bar alpha dot phi zero, so does phi square by the chain, and so on and so forth. The same applies to phi bar for the anti-chiral. So this is a sum of chiral or anti-chiral. Phi bar phi is not a chiral or anti-chiral. It's a real superfield. It's a very special case of a real superfield because the diagonal of this is equal to itself, but it's not killed by the alpha or the bar alpha dot. So you see, no? All these terms are not chiral superfield, the pieces, except these ones. Okay? Is this clear? Now, a chiral superfield has an expansion. That's why I wrote sigma. Sigma can be phi, phi square, phi cube, phi to the fourth, will have its own expansion. The top component will be a box of something complicated, but a box. And then the integral theta 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 bar theta bar is a box. It's even more than a total space time derivative. So it gives contribution zero to the integration. So I didn't write it because it was just stupid to do it. Just wasting of time. Put it in a more mathematical sense, words, two chiral potentials, k prime and k, which differ by, so if you start from a chiral potential and you add any function, any holomorphic function of phi, start from your chiral potential, which is a function of phi and phi bar. Okay? With all the properties. And then they find a new chiral potential, a transformed one, which is equal to k plus some function of phi only, plus some other function of phi bar only, such that this is the diagonal of this to preserve reality of k prime. This k prime is another chiral potential because it's a function which has all the properties of a chiral potential because k does, and this plus this also does. Okay, this is an holomorphic function of phi, and this is an anti-holomorphic function of phi bar. If you integrate in superspace, k prime, this is equal to the integral di two theta bar of k. Modulo total space-time derivative, which we don't care. Why? Because these two guys just give a total space-time derivative. So, a chiral potential is defined modulo such transformation, which is called chiral transformation. Okay, this is just an aside remark. And this is the reason why we didn't consider m and m equal to zero here again, because the difference will be defined a nuclear potential which differs only by terms like this, phi square, phi cube, phi to the cube, phi bar square, phi bar cube, phi to the cube. Remember, we cannot have covariant derivatives. And so there was no point to add them. You can, they are different functions. These are different, k and k prime are different functions, but not as far as what we look at, namely as not as superfield, but as field once you have derived, integrated in superspace, because they differ only by a total space-time derivative, what we don't care about, which we don't care about. Okay, is this clear? Okay, so far so good. Well, so far not so good because we are very happy with this, but it seems we cannot do anything more unless we accept to describe non-renormalizable interaction. Non-renormalizable says that you have brutally the Lagrangian negative mass dimension for coupling, so this is that even though supersimmetry is better behavior than non-supersimmetry theory, still if you have a negative mass dimension coupling, this is it. I mean, these are non-renormalizable. Maybe they can behave a little bit better than a non-supersymmetric, but still, you have this in the Lagrangian. So the question is, can we describe interactions? Notice that if you don't care about renormalizability, well, it's easy to see that since phi bar phi give the kinetic term, it's clear that higher order in phi and phi bar in this sum will create something different from kinetic terms, so we create interactions. More than just quadratic term in the fields, obviously, because you will have, you know, phi square, phi bar square. So if you multiply, you will have more complicated. So this gives interactions, if you allow, but non-normalizable ones. Okay, the kinetic term is already here. So higher order here will not give kinetic term, of course, will give something else. You can compute it, it's nothing difficult. So you can have interactions in a supersymmetric way, but not just non-renormalizable interaction. So the question is, can we do something better? Can we describe renormalizable interaction in a supersymmetric way? Well, clearly, the integral in full superspace doesn't help, because this is the only answer. So we have to invent something. Okay, so let me do a mathematical parenthesis. I delete this, can I delete this? This is fine, we have it and we are happy with it. Okay. Let me consider a generic chiral superfield, sigma. So I'm making a parenthesis, that's why I don't see. So forget about phi. Super, you have a chiral superfield, phi. Sigma. Can be phi, phi square, phi cube, whatever, no? For example, if we start from phi. So we have seen that the integral in full superspace of this guy is zero. I said it many, many times. Why? Because this is a box, and then integrating before x gives zero. So this is zero. That's why, for example, the first non-trivial term in the Keeler potential was phi bar phi. That is not a kind of superfield, it's a real superfield, because it's darker in itself, and it's not annihilated by the alpha or the bar alpha dot. And was given something different from sigma. But if you were just integrating phi, or phi squared, the discussion I deleted here, you get zero. Okay. But now, let me do the following exercise. Let me compute this integral instead. So let me integrate sigma, not in full superspace, but only in half superspace, in the chiral part of superspace. Let's say that chiral anti-chiral part, because theta, theta bar, okay, if you want. So let me integrate sigma in half superspace. Then what I get here? Well, first of all, this integral is non-vanishing to start with, for sure. Because now what is selected in this integration? Which is not a total space time derivative. So first of all, this is different from zero. So let me call this I. It's not the same I as before. So I is different from zero. Vabbè, this is a mathematical observation, an obvious mathematical observation. Namely, it's different from zero, even modulo total space time derivative is different from zero. Now, notice in doing this computation, you might be confused because here you have been, what happens to this? Remember that sigma being a chiral superfield, you can write it in this way. And then expand from y to x. But what is the difference between y and x? I don't remember, maybe there is an I, but anyway, the difference between I and X is a total space-time derivative times a number. So when integrating d2 theta, you can think of sigma being just a function of Y, is much simpler. So this automatically gives you minus F of X. What do I mean? So, why I do say so. In other words, when you have to integrate a chiral superfield in half superspace, you can think in the y-coordinate terms, which is simple because you have less component. Why? Because the difference between y and x, you are doing a mistake if you work with y. But the mistake you are doing is just the difference between y and x, which is just a total space-time derivative when you expectedly expand. And total space-time derivative will be killed by d4x. So this integral integrating Y and X is a different thing. But once you then do this, the result doesn't. So for simplicity, when you compute this integral, I is different from zero, okay? Not all, but in doing the integration, you can work in the Y coordinate. You don't have to become crazy with X. Here you couldn't, before you couldn't when I computed this guy, because here you had the problem of 5-5 bar, and so there were pieces from one side with, but here if they don't, okay? So it's a big simplification. So every time you integrate a kind of superfield in a superspace, you can work in the Y coordinate, or converse in the Y bar coordinate for the empty car, which makes, as you will see explicitly, life much simpler. But this tells you that this integral not only is different from zero, but is a supersymmetric invariant. Why? Because how does this integral transform under supersymmetry transformation? So how does this integral transform, this part, before doing the under supersymmetry transformation? Well, since this is nothing but f, this is equal to minus, if you want, p for x, f sigma of x, right? You agree with me? So how does I transform under supersymmetry transformation? Well, it depends on how f transforms, right? If you go back to the list I deleted here, which is generic for any kind of superfield, that was phi, but can be sigma. Here, there was the transformation here was, remember, I square root of 2 d mu psi sigma mu epsilon bar, right? So how does the f component of a Taylor superfield transform as a Susi transformation as a total space-time derivative modulo numbers? So this not only is different from zero, but is also Susi invariant. Is this clear? This is a crucial point. So what we have learned is that if you take a kind of superfield and you integrate it in half superspace, in full superspace is a Susi invariant, but unfortunately it's also zero, so it doesn't tell you anything. In half superspace is still a Susi invariant, but it's different from zero. So it seems that mathematically speaking, this is another kind of integral we can consider in our final goal to construct supersymmetric invariant Lagrangian, modulo total space-time derivative, describing the self-interaction of Taylor superfield. Right? At least it seems promising. Okay? Good. Modulo space-time derivative. Okay. Let me make an aside comment that we will use later on. Okay, so this is okay. Now, before thinking a bit more about this thing and what we get, let me make just an aside comment for the terminology. Let me notice the following mathematical fact. Consider some superfield y and consider the following integral d4x d2 theta and d2 theta bar of y. Okay? This can be rewritten in the following way. I write and then explain. Why? This is true. What I did from here to here, I converted the integration in d2 theta bar with a derivation. Remember that that this is equal to this. So I can do this change. And this is not d bar. I mean, okay, and the same for d bar, okay? D bar is not quite D bar. It's this plus something else, remember. But this something else is a total space-time derivative. So in trailing D bar D2 theta bar with d bar square, I just is correct modulo a total space time derivative, which is again killed by d4x. So this step is correct. Again, if there was not this, this was not, was wrong, but this is correct. Okay? But now you see that I have transformed an integral in full superspace in an, as an integral in half superspace, right? What does this mean? That any integral in full superspace can always be rewritten as an integral in half superspace. And indeed, this field, this why was a superfield? This is Swiss invariant. Well, also this is Swiss invariant. Why? Because this is an integral in half superspace. This is supersymmetric invariant because it's the integral in full superspace of a superfield. Okay. This is Swiss invariant because it's the integral in half superspace of in the anti-chiral part of superspace, sorry, in chiral superspace, in half superspace of what? Of a field, let me call it, I don't know, X, which is a chiral superfield. Why? Because in order to show that X is chiral, I have to prove that this is zero, right? But this is d bar, and you can prove easily that d bar cube is a zero identical as an operator. Because there are too many thetas, basically. So, let me put it different. Any integral in full superspace can be rewritten as an integral in half superspace. But the converse is not true. That is, it's not true that any integral in half superspace can be rewritten as anything in full superspace. Let me give you an example. Let's consider a chiral superfield. This integral, as we have discussed already just now, I don't know, phi square, is a supersymmetric invariant, blah, blah, blah. But you cannot write it as an integral in full superspace of something. Because you don't have covariant derivative to convert this back. Okay? So definition, any integral, integral in full superspace are called D terms. The technical reason being that in this integration what is saved is the theta d theta bar theta bar component. And historically, the most generic superfield Y that we wrote at the very beginning of this discussion, there was a D here. So as a convention, this is called a D-term, in the sense that this iter provides you the D-term to make it, to be more precise, the highest, the theta bar, the bar component, but as a slang, a D-term. And a D-term can always be converted in an integral in half superspace. But the converse is not true. So integral in half superspace are divided in two parts, some of which can be rewritten as D-terms, some other which cannot. Those which cannot are called F-terms. Why F term? Because in the expansion of the more general superfield, for historical reason, F was the name of the theta-theta component, and F bar of the theta-bar-theta-bar component. Okay, so the summary is that if you have kind of superfields around, you can write two kinds of supersymmetric integral. D terms, the integral in full superspace of a clear potential, which should have, and F term, the integral in half superspace of chiral superfield. Now I want to do the last, the same exercise we did here, we now want to do here. So let's write the more general function of phi only, not just phi and phi bar, only phi, and say what property should this have in order to be blah blah blah. Okay? Maybe this is where interaction that we like are sitting. So let me come back then to our problem after this mathematical detour. So we have our chiral superfield phi and phi bar, of course, and we ask, let's take our superfield phi and we ask, let's write the following integral d4x d2 theta of some function of phi. What are the properties this W should have in order for this to be a putative supersymmetric piece of a Lagrange? Okay, the first property is that W should be a holomorphic function of time, which means that dw in d phi bar should be zero. So that should depend on phi, not on phi bar. Why? Because in order for this integral to be supersymmetric invariant, w should be a chiral superfield, like sigma. Should be not a generic function of phi, a function of phi which is a chiral superfield, still chiral. So let's compute this. We have to prove that this is zero. This is equal to dw in d phi d bar alpha dot phi plus dw in d phi bar d bar alpha dot phi bar. Do you agree with me? This is equal to what? Well, d bar alpha dot phi is zero because phi is a chiral superfield. So this is killed. But d bar alpha dot phi bar is not zero. It's the alpha phi is zero, phi bar which is zero, but d bar alpha dot phi bar is not zero. Since this should be zero to be so that w is a chiral superfield and therefore this is Swiss invariant, it's needed that dw in d phi bar is zero. So in order for this to be, for w to be a chiral superfield, which is a necessary condition for this integral to be Swiss invariant, as we discussed a modulo total space-time derivative, as 5 minutes ago, w should be a holomorphic function of phi. Is this clear? Okay, so first requirement is that w should be a holomorphic function of phi. Why? Because this ensures that w is a chiral superfield and therefore the integral I is a Swiss invariant. So supersymmetric, if you want. Modulo total space time derivative. Okay. Okay. So this is the analogous of this. For k was enough to be a superfield. Here it should be a chiral superfield, W, and so the extra requirement, okay? In order for the Lagrangian to be real, this is not real, you see, because W phi is a chiral superfield, so it's complex. So you have to add, to start with the Hermitian conjugate. It's only this that makes sense. So why you have to add the Hermitian conjugate? To ensure reality. Because the lower, okay? Well, remember, the lowest component is complex. The F component, if this is a scalar, is also a scalar. If this is complex, this is also complex, or theta, theta. And so, you have to add the conjugate. For K, this is what needed, was automatically, because the theta, theta, theta bar, theta bar component at the same reality condition of the lowest, but the lowest was real because 5 bar 5 was real. The lowest here is not real. Okay? So you have to add the Hermitian conjugate. The second property, W, should not contain derivative. Why? Because the alpha phi is not a chiral superfield. Okay, should not contain the alpha and the bar alpha dot. The bar alpha dot you can put, but it gives zero because once acting on phi gives zero because phi is a chiral superfield. But this is different from zero. And it's a superfield. But it's not a chiral superfield. Phi is a chiral superfield. The alpha phi, as a rule, is not a chiral superfield. If you act with the bar alpha dot, you don't get zero here because there is this guy, they don't commute. So it does not, so it can be a function of, so W should be a function of phi, namely, not depending on phi bar. Not only, but should be a function of phi without derivative. is a different reason from that. Here, the absence of these things was needed to, so to avoid higher derivative terms. Here is a needed in order to ensure supersymmetry, because then this will not be a Carrier superfield anymore. Finally, W should have dimension 3 Why? Well, for the same reason as K should have dimension 2. Why? Because the dimension of W is the dimension of its lowest component as any superfield. What is saved by this integration is the F component, the theta component. Since theta theta is dimension minus 1, remember, because no? W will have an expansion, and then you will have theta theta, FW, let me go this way. This has dimension minus 1, right? So the dimension of F is 1 plus the dimension of the lowest. Since should be 4, this should be 3. In the same vein as K should have dimension 2, because the theta 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 bar component had dimension 2 plus 2, which is 4. So this was the reason why this should have dimension 2, and now W should have dimension 3. Again, integrating this is equal to the theta 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 bar component. And this component has a dimension which is plus 2 times the dimension of the lowest. And since the sum should be 4, this should be 2. The same here. Integrating this, forget about the, this is equal to the F component of W, which is the theta theta, theta component. And so, which should have dimension 4, because the Lagrangian has dimension 4. So for this to have dimension 4, since this is minus 1, this all has dimension 3, which is the dimension of the lowest 3. So W should have dimension 3. Is it clear? Okay, so if you take into account all these requirements, as we did here, there is only one solution, which is that W should be the following thing, n from 1 to infinity of an phi n. Indeed, this function does not depend on phi bar, does not contain covariant derivative. And as far as the dimension, again, as before, this will tell you something about AN, the dimension of the couplings. So for phi equal to 1, 2, and 3, this will be respectively dimension 2, 1, and 0. So either supernormalizable theory or renormalizable theory. For phi bigger than 3, so phi to the 4, phi to the 5, this again becomes negative mass dimension. So what is the big difference between this and K? What is the big difference between this and that? That here, beside the kinetic term, as soon as you wanted something more, you were already non-renormalizable interactions. Because when m and n were bigger than 1, this automatic was giving something interesting, interaction, but unfortunately non-renormalizable, because C had negative mass dimension automatically. Here there is a room, because A1, A2, and A3 are fine, have either dimension, since this should have dimension 3, phi has dimension 1, phi dimension 1, so A1 is dimension 2, because 2 plus 1 is 3, A2 is dimension 1, so positive, and this is dimensionless. So, if you ask to have renormalizable interaction, the answer is not nothing as before, it's something. 5 plus 5 squared plus 5 cubed. So it seems not only that we have found supersymmetry in an alternative for a supersymmetric invariant piece of guy, but that there is room for renormalizable interaction or something, we'll see, but something which is not infinite term and is renormalizable. So it seems you have found a way. Okay? We will compute it. Eh? Okay? So if renormalizability is required for the Killer potential, the answer was just 5/5, which is the kinetic term. That's it. Here the answer is that W is at most cubic. But up to cubic is fine. Is it clear? Good. Tomorrow we'll compute it and see what we get. Before closing the lecture, I just want to make one final comment, which has to do with the R symmetry. Remember that in N equal to 1 supersymmetric theory, there is a U1R symmetry principle. You can have a U1R symmetry. Which is an option you can have to have this. Now the question is, does the requirement of your theory, not only supersymmetric invariant, but also R symmetry invariant, pose extra constraints on K and W? Let's see. Consider a chiral superfield phi. Remember the property of U1R, the R symmetry, is that is the only symmetry of the internal symmetry which does not commute with the supersymmetry generators by definition. So suppose you have a chiral superfield phi, and suppose that the lowest component has a charge R. Then its psi component has a charge, I claim, R charge R minus 1, and F has R charge R minus 2. Why? Well, because we have to remember our convention that we introduced, that R Q alpha is equal to minus Q alpha. So since going from phi to psi you act with Q, if phi is a charge R, it's easy to check that psi will have a charge R minus 1 and F R minus 2. Okay? Therefore, it follows that the R charge of theta is plus 1. Because if this is a charge R, this is R minus 1, since you cannot add pairs with apples, theta is a charge plus 1. Like the dimension, the mass dimension we are computing a few minutes ago. And R theta bar is minus 1 instead. Because remember that this is minus, but R, because of this, this is plus. Because the dagger of this is this with a plus. So the same, in the same way as phi psi and f are related by this, phi bar, psi bar, f bar are related by this, q bar, and so there is a plus. So you go from R bar, R plus 1, plus 2. So it's the opposite. Which implies that the R charge of d theta is minus 1. Because remember that theta in d theta is d in d theta. So it's in the denominator, so it's the opposite charge. Remember, a U1 charge, if the inverse is the minus the charge, no? So, so the R charge of d to theta is minus 2, right? So if the R the U1R symmetry is a symmetry, there is an R symmetry, meaning that the Lagrangian should be invariant under U1R symmetry, should be a scalar under U1R transformation. And for this to be the case, implies that the R charge of W should be 2. So there is an extra constraint that we will see at work, that if the R symmetry is a symmetry, it means that all fields are charged under this symmetry, and W should be a function of phi, I don't know if it's phi, but having R charge equal to 2. If it doesn't, it means that you don't have such a this symmetry explicitly broken, it's not there, so you don't have this symmetry, which is fine, just to know. So the R symmetry requirement impose some constraints on W, because require that W should have R charge 2. And this, as we will see, might impose extra constraint. On W itself, okay? What is the R charge of K? Well, the R charge of D2 theta is minus 2. The R charge of D2 theta bar is plus 2, so the sum is 0. Since D should have R charge 0, the R charge of K should be 0 instead. Okay? This also imposes constraint, and very simple, it's easy to see. What constraint? Well, look here. Well, I tell you what the constraint is, that C M N is 0 if M is different from N. Why? Because for any m equal to n, so C11, C22, C33, C34, we always have 5 r and 5 with the same power. This is an n. And since if 5 has a charge r, 5 r clearly has a charge minus r, because the U1 r charge goes into minus self under daggering, right? The product of an equal number of 5 and 5 bar is R charge 0. But the product of an equal number of 5 and 5 bar cannot have R charge 0. And even if you then add the Hermitian conjugate, it doesn't change anything in this respect. So a clear potential which should satisfy R symmetry, not only should have that all the C's are 0, but the one with the same MNN. Notice that the kinetic term we have written satisfies not only renormalizability 5 bar 5, but also R symmetry. This is a comment. For W, we will see concretely what this does mean. For example, I give you an example, and then I finish. So suppose you are describing a renormalizable theory of one single chiral superfield. Therefore, the W phi is phi plus A1 phi, A2 phi square, plus A3 phi cube. Okay? This is the only solution for a renormalizable theory, as we have seen. Suppose there is an R symmetry, means that W should have R charge 2. But since the R charge of W is inherited from the R charge of phi, so phi will have some R charge. You understand that for this W have R charge 2, you cannot have these three terms, only one of them. Which one? Well, depends on the R charge of phi. But because if this has R charge 2, phi means has R charge 2. But then phi squared has R charge 4 and this has R charge 6, so the wool cannot have R charge 2. Because the couplings are numbers, I mean, are not charged under the, are not acted upon the Q and Q bar, A1, A2, A3, no? So requiring this will tell you that W is only one element, one component, either phi cube or phi square or phi, but nothing else, not two of them. So if you have a superpotential with both a phi square and phi cube term, for example, then you can say, without doing computation, that your theory does not preserve the U1R symmetry. Because your Lagrangian is supersymmetric, is renormalizable, is fantastic Lagrangian, but does not respect the 1R symmetry because the superpotential automatically cannot have R charge 2. So you see how simple this is. As we will see, if you have more than one Carrier superfield, two, three, four Carrier superfield, then you can have mixed term and there can be compensation. So you can have more terms in the superpotential. But you need to have more than one Carrier superfield with different charges. But if you have only one, as we are doing now, only one of these three can survive. Is this clear? Okay. Tomorrow we will do what we did for the Carrier potential, for the kinetic term. We will consider this guy and integrate in superspace and see what we get as a function of phi, psi, and f. Okay?
Yes.